Last week, following the sermon, in response to the question, what must I do to be saved? The question was asked, if we already are, then what difference does it make what we do? Well, it makes a lot of difference, according to Leviticus and according to Paul writing to the church at Corinth and according to Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount. These are impossible ethics. Virtually impossible to live by. But they are an ethic, in my view, in my understanding of gospel and law, is that the gospel cuts the legs out from underneath the law insofar as we turn the law or the teachings, the Torah, into a way to appease God. The law was never intended to do that. The Torah was meant to teach people how to live as human beings in community with each other and with the earth itself. And what happened along the way was that the teachings of how to live with each other and with the earth ended up being something they were never meant to be, a way to appease an angry God. So Luther then comes to the realization that God is not wrathful. God is essentially loving and graceful and merciful. And so after Luther, there comes John Calvin. Everybody loves to hate John Calvin, except those who have read him. Now, even some of them don't like him. But what Calvin did and what the Reformed wing of the Reformation did was to say, grace does not nullify law. It restores law to its proper function. It redeems us for the doing of the teachings, not because doing them appeases God, but because by grace we are empowered to fulfill the spirit of the law of love. Are you with me? So it's not, for some people, the Old Testament is just, that's just law. Well, Jesus didn't say, I've come to abolish the law and the prophets. He said, I've come to fulfill them. And so we too are to fulfill the law, the teachings, to live by the teachings. But the teachings are impossible, aren't they? Now, I don't know, maybe they aren't for you, but they sure are hard for me. Groucho Marx, remember Groucho Marx with his rubber chicken or duck or whatever it was on Groucho Marx? My mother used to love that show. So did I when I was growing up. That rubber chicken would come down. Anyway, Groucho Marx said, I don't care to belong to a club that accepts people who would accept me as a member. Well, I sort of felt like that my whole life. You ever felt like that? I don't want to belong to a club that would accept a member like me. I want a club. It's like Bob Hope said when he was given the presidential gold medal. He said, I'm feeling really humble, but I have enough character to get over it. What I want us to do this morning is distinguish between excellence and perfection. Striving for excellence and perfection. Because if grace means just don't do anything, just lay on your couch, turn the television on, forget about your neighbor, crack open a beer or two or three or four, and just let the world go by, you're not responsible for anything, then that's cheap grace. And that's the grace that Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was executed, hanged by the Third Reich in Germany, condemned. Grace is costly. Grace costs us something. It requires something of us. So what is it that grace requires? Well, I think you know as well as I, maybe better, that the wisdom of the world that Paul talks about, it divides us into the righteous and the unrighteous, the saved, the damned, divides us by race, by class, by nationality, by culture, by intelligence or lack of it, so forth and so on. We divide ourselves in a thousand different ways. So the wisdom of the world is to divide ourselves into clubs, basically. But that's not the wisdom of God. And that's not the perfection of God. So when Jesus is talking about God, what does he say? God doesn't do that. God doesn't send a little rain on your treehouse and not send it to the neighbors, or the sun, or the wind, or the snow. It falls on everybody just the same. God doesn't pay attention to the distinctions that the world makes that divides us. We're all one. We all exist in the hand of providence, and we are meant to love each other in the way that God loves the creation itself and the whole human race. So, Jesus says, you want to be perfect? You want to be perfect? Do what God does. Love without discrimination. You must, therefore, as the recipients of grace, live like that. Some of us grew up with horrible expectations, parental expectations sometimes. Maybe it was an uncle, maybe it was a grandparent. Maybe it was a teacher's, maybe it was something that just came right out of our own selves, feeling that we had to be perfect, flawless, and that the Christian life was to be flawless, to be without blemish. Otto Kleppinger, the great maestro, was not known for handing out compliments. He was a pretty hard taskmaster. He wanted perfection from his orchestras. But there was one particular rehearsal of a Beethoven symphony where the orchestra just outdid itself. And when at the end of the piece, Otto Kleppinger said, "Good!" And the whole orchestra stood up and applauded. He said, "Not that good." Haven't you had that experience? That's good, but it's not that good. You brought home a B. You're supposed to bring home an A. You brought home an A, but you could have had an A plus. Some way or other, all of us have had the experience of not measuring up. To what? Not measuring up to what? So as I have come to this stage of my life, I am increasingly of the mind of Groucho Marx, who said, "Well, art is art, isn't it? Still, on the other hand, water is water, and east is east, and west is west, and if you take cranberries and stew them like applesauce, they taste much more like prunes than rhubarb does. Now you tell me what you know." I've come to the conclusion I don't know much. And I'm pretty sure you don't either. But that's okay. We're not called to perfection in the way in which we normally think about it. Because to place ourselves under the rule of perfection in terms of worldly wisdom is to make ourselves the judge and the jury on others and on ourselves. And what Jesus does in this Sermon on the Mount is to say, stop thinking of God as a judge. God is your lover. God loves you. God is love. And the judgment, the only judgment, is one that is realized in time, and we bring it on ourselves, whether we love or do not love, whether we seek to divide and conquer others or split ourselves in half and hate part of us and love part of us, or whether we come to the fullness of our salvation, the full healing. That's what salvation is wholeness. There's not a person in this room who isn't a bit of an odd duck. I know you guys. And you know me. And that's the way we're made. So let's get over it. Let's start loving like that. Let's start loving ourselves like that. Love yourself like that. Love yourself. Begin to love yourself the way God loves you. And stop judging yourself. Stop judging others. Any club that would have a member like me is not a club I want to belong to. Cut the clubs out. No, I won't go there. Yes, I will. Since I'm on to Groucho Marx, Groucho Marx said that all people are born alike, except Republicans and Democrats. Sometimes don't we go there? sometimes all people are born alike, except if I'm a Democrat and you're a Republican, except for you, if I'm a Republican and you're a Democrat, except for you, all people are born alike. The sun and the rain fall on everyone alike. Thanks be to God, and by God's grace, may we be emboldened to live as responsible agents and ministers of this costly grace. Amen.